Welcome back, everyone. It's time for our second Challenge Stone semifinal. Please join me in welcoming to the stage the first competitor, Mr. Dan Frodan Cho. A wonderful entrance. Sorry, I was entranced in Dan's entrance. But let's see how his competitor, all the way from Finland, Janne Savits-Mikkonen, does. All right, guys, come on, join me in the center of the stage. Thumbs down from Dan, that's harsh. Now, Dan, you mentioned in the intro that you were going to crush Savits. Exactly how are you planning on doing that?
In true Tempo Storm fashion, I make next level decks that never work out. So I'm just going to bet on my luck that I draw correctly anyways. Looks like a Maz did just the past game, so.
Now, Janne, do you have a particular strategy in mind here?
I do. You'll see in a minute.
Oh, I can't wait to see. Well, guys, I know what good friends you are. You're two of the best friends on the Hearthstone scene, and I just wanted to give you a chance before you totally ruin this friendship to share one of your best memories of each other. So Dan, you go first.
I think my most fond memory of Savits was the first time I ever shared a sauna experience with him. And if you ever had a chance to share a sauna with a Finn, definitely do it.
All right, Janne, same question.
I don't know, just with my early casting, I really appreciate what Frodan has done to help me out.
Wonderful. Well, now that you guys are established as friends, I'm going to let you ruin it yourself, so please shake hands. Cold-blooded. And I'm going to give it back to the casters on the desk.
Thank you, Rachel. Joining me at the desk here, I have Hyped. How are you feeling today? Ready to cast some Challenge
Stone? I'm good. I'm ready to cast. I was
you guys have
out
your teammate out there. You guys have Frodan.
Yeah, he's being a little BM. I don't know. We're usually a little nicer than that. He's not really representing us that well.
Are you guys going to, give an unfavorable opinion, unfavorable assessment? Maybe you think Savits is going to win in this situation from what you've seen from the trash talking?
I don't know. Based
and
on that confidence,
inverse?
I'm going for Frodan. They've never actually played, have they?
I don't think they have, honestly, but I also got to give it to Frodan. He is much, much better dressed, though.
Well, I guess that's true.
That's just a fact.
All right, well, we do have their deck-building moments as well, so let's take a look at that, and let's see if being well-dressed actually correlates to having good Hearthstone decks.
Jersey looks good on stage, man.
Yeah, that could be. All right, so again, this happened earlier in the week. Again, it is being sped up, so you guys don't have to endure the full 25 minutes, but this is Savits on the left, Frodan on the right, building their decks. It seems like Frodan is a little bit slower to get into the groove here, but I feel like both players are kind of taking their time compared to the Kibler Amaz deck building session. I think Kibler and Amaz both kind of just went all in right off the bat. It seemed like, maybe they had a little bit more experience coming up with very creative stuff, but sometimes the fine-tuning does play a big role in the deck creation as well.
Absolutely. I mean, it looks like we're seeing some pretty standard Dragon Priest list. Kind of the first thing that comes to mind for a lot of people is just a very strong, proactive deck that translates well to ranked play, and you can kind of build in this Challenge Stone under this rule set. So I wouldn't be surprised to see both players end up playing their Priest deck. It's just very solid, and I'm more interested in what the non-Priest classes they're going to choose are. It is also worth pointing out they're playing the Sisters again. I think it's going to be pretty common. I would imagine they're the most played legendaries in the format under the rule set. And that's just because you want a I mean, Handlock is a deck that's traditionally a lot slower in ranked mode, but it does let you play an 8-8 minion on turn 4 every single game if you draw Mountain Giant. So that alone is just so powerful in a format where Big Game Hunter is not allowed that maybe it's just worth building that kind of archetype, even if you still have to fit 10 more expensive cards in your deck.
Another aspect to that is the secondary powerful minions in the mid-game from the Handlock. You have the Voidcallers and the Drakes, and we have seen zero silences so far in the deck building process.
I have to ask, was Mal'Ganis a raid boss? I don't think he was on the list.
No, he's not on the list. Actually, the raid bosses selected are only the neutral ones to not give classes kind of like artificial advantages. But, you know, there's something to be said for both sides. In the end, we went with that, and no discounts for Warlock, as it turns out.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense then. Oh, we're actually going to see our first Warrior, I think, being built. Haven't seen this class yet. I mean, honestly...
We haven't seen Hunter yet either.
That's true. On ladder, Warrior is the deck. You know, traditional Control Warrior would be the deck where we would see most of these raid bosses played usually. I mean, things like Onyxia, Nefarian, Ragnaros, all these cards saw competitive play in Control Warrior at some point. So it makes sense to, you know, build a deck with just all of them in it.
Sure, and then you have 4 1-mana removals. Pretty strong.
Absolutely, yeah. Execute and Shield Slam get even better in a format with no Big Game Hunter. Brawl, also a type of card that can help deal with larger minions.
You also have options like Bouncing Blade and Crush, which also might be pretty good.
I was really hoping to see Bouncing Blade, and every time Saviz went near that card, he's kind of teasing me, but it looks like he hasn't put it in the deck yet, at least. Bouncing Blade is a card that's not very well known, but it is particularly good against a situation where there's two big minions. It was actually, like, I learned about this when someone made a post about how ridiculous Bouncing Blade is against two Mountain Giants. Because it kills one and gets the other one usually to 1 or 2 health, which you can often kill with a weapon.
No, it makes a lot of sense. I definitely see that card being very effective here. But the players recognize, you know...
Larvobot.
Yeah.
That's... Oh, you put it in! Oh, I took it out.
Oh. Almost committed.
Looks like Prodan's kind of going the mid-range strat. He just built Rogue, now he's building Shaman. Rogue had the two saps, and then Shaman has the two hexes, which are really cheap removal.
Mm-hmm. We also saw Gormok the Impaler in one of Saviz's decks. I believe it was the Warrior. And I think that's a decent inclusion, because you have to have so many high-curve minions. And in fact, some of the high-curve minions that you want to play, you know, like kind of like ones that Amaz actually put in, like Sylvanas, maybe even like Dr. Boom, aren't part of the list. So you have to counterbalance that, you know. Is it better to have... a 4-4 that does nothing, which is Gormok the Impaler in a lot of cases in this deck, over a Shredder, if you can put in a bonus like Dr. Boom or Sylvanas, and maybe it is the case.
It's definitely an interesting trade-off to think about. I mean, honestly, so far from what we've seen, I feel like Frodan is playing the most unique decks by a mile. I mean, we're seeing Shaman, Rogue, like, it's gonna be interesting to see if these things pan out.
Yeah, I mean, just in terms of the class balancing, I believe Amaz is the only player to run Druid, but Frodan is the only player to run Shaman and Rogue, so he does have his flavor in more places than just deck building, I suppose. Let's take a look at some of the cards, some of the raid bosses that they went with out of the 19 available. Here we see Frodan's. He does pick a pretty wide variety. I'm kind of surprised that we haven't seen too much Myxna. Like, isn't Myxna an all right card?
Yeah,
it kills like most of these and stays alive.
It does cost 6 mana. I mean, some of these expensive minions, even if you can kill them for less mana, they still get their value, you know. Fugin and Stalag still get their value, Ragnaros, Nefarian, so it is a strong card, though. I'm surprised we're not seeing more of it.
All right, well, let's see if Saviz ended up including that one. Well, it looks like he has Major Domo Executus instead. I believe that was in his Mage deck. Now, Hype, you've been kind of a Freeze Mage expert throughout your time playing Hearthstone.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think a Major Domo Executive's viability in a slow Mage deck is?
I think he mostly hurts you for the most part. Usually you're super worried about the Big Game Hunter, but even if there's no Big Game Hunter, he's only got 7 health. You take him out, then your hero only has 7 HP. Seems pretty dangerous.
What about the Garrison Commander Dream?
Garrison Commander Dream.
Kuldara Drake Dream.
You gotta get like 4 Inspire effects to make it worth it, I think.
Well, I'm hoping that Saviz proves you guys wrong and crushes Frodan in Ragnaros mode, but we will have to see. I think the players are almost ready to get into the games. What are your predictions, guys? Just seeing some of the deck creations, are we going with the wild creative stuff or just the wild class options of Frodan?
I'm still saying Frodan, just based on the confidence and the attire.
I'm saying Frodan solely based off the attire.
I'm saying Saviz solely based on the inversely proportional ability to trash talk your opponent and ability to win games.
That's a good point.
Hello.
Because Frodan clearly won the trash talking battle earlier. That was unanimous.
Right. So that's not going to bode well for him in the actual game, unfortunately.
Exactly.
I wish that same philosophy applied to ladder. You know, I wish that when I got emote spammed.
Yeah.
Justice would be served just once in a while, Crip. Just not every game, but once in a while.
Well, Frodan opens with Priest, a pretty popular class so far in the openings. We've seen Priest take two games so far, and Frodan does have an excellent opener. He has the other sister this time. It is Aedas Darkbane, and Darkbane does do, I believe, 3 damage randomly to one of your opponent's targets once Darkbane is targeted with one of your own spells. Frodan doesn't have a spell, but looks like we might see a battle of the sisters here.
Do you have any idea what Savitz is going for with the Ice Bear? It seems like it'd be pretty bad in this format. You have like a lot of slow guys, the 8 HP doesn't feel like it's going to do much.
I think you're missing the point behind Major Domo. Major Domo is a lot better when you extend that life with some armor, perhaps.
So turn into 15.
Mm-hmm.
It's like he's committed to the Major Domo plan, I like it. When we were actually talking about this format backstage a bit, Crip, you mentioned how powerful Mad Scientist is in this format, because Sigurd's like Effigy, Mirror Entity gets so much better with expensive minions.
All right, well, here comes Mind Games. Maybe it's going to be a Major Domo.
Mistakes were made.
Well, what a perfect time to play Ice Barrier, too. So, Look at that. He knew he would get Mind Games into Doomsayer, thus giving him an opportunity to develop a worthless secret that otherwise, you know, might not be played. Ice Barrier, look at that. Interesting how that worked out.
Yeah, I mean, all calculated.
Calculated indeed.
But yeah, Mind Games definitely an opportunity for Frodan to kind of, you know, slip under the mirror entity, the potential mirror entity. And yeah, now that plan is just completely wrecked by Doomsayer.
Wait, hold on. He has Ice Barrier in duplicate, and he has a secret active already.
That's neither one of those, because they're both playable.
Right, well, right. I believe that's Ice Block. I believe Ice Block was in his deck.
Oh, is he not playing the like entity or effigy or anything like that?
I believe not, actually. I think he took the other route. He's playing closer to a freeze mage.
Okay, well, I mean, if that is the case, if Frodan can play a minion this turn without losing it, then it's actually not that bad that he got Doomsayer, because he retains initiative here.
Mm-hmm. I believe Saviz actually plays Freeze Mage with Major Domo sometimes on his stream or some stuff like that, and I think his success is reasonable enough that he keeps doing it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of pro players that definitely like the deck. They think it's almost good enough for Constructed. Guys like Dog, I see playing it a good amount. Yeah, they're definitely big fans.
All right, well, Saviz will be able to coin out the Ren Black Hand to take out any Legendary that's played, and whoa, that's Fugin, and Saviz has Stalag.
Oh man, so the second one to die is basically
the game-winning one.
Right.
And Saviz also has duplicate, and if he's playing random to Stalag, those are two minions you definitely want two more of in this situation and deck.
Absolutely. I mean, Saviz is behind on board, but he's in a position where his next turn is going to swing the game so much, and as Frodan, it's going to be so tough to recover from that point. He can't really kill Saviz's minions because he can't give them two copies of any of them.
Frodan was animated enough that we actually saw his entire train of thought. It was, how does he have 3 secrets and not Mirror Entity and attacks? Oh, that's how. Ice Barrier. Well, Rend takes out the 4-7. I have to say, you were right about this one, Reynad. It seems that card is pretty good in this format.
Yeah. How good is Ren Blackhand? Crip confirms it.
When you have to play 10 targets in every deck, pretty good.
Frodan choosing not to proc the duplicate, although it wouldn't actually hurt him here because he has no legendaries on the board currently, and he's going to have to deal with it eventually, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, he does have 3 legendaries in hand, so I don't think there's any way he can win if this gets duplicated, basically.
This gives him time to duplicate the Stalags, though, which are Stalags that res Thaddeus.
Stalags even worse.
Exactly.
There's no chance you duplicate the Stalags.
It's one of those situations where just everything is a really, really tough spot to be in, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, Saviz is going with a ping there because he plans on playing the Blizzard and ping down next turn. Also, a 1 health heal is often inefficient enough that you don't end up going with it.
And Northshire Cleric is going to give Frodan the option to draw a card here.
Is someone injured?
And play Twilight Guardian, most likely this turn. He decided not to play Chromagus because it does only have 8 health, and Savitz would be able to run his Fugin into it and then finish it off with hero power.
Mind control from Frodan. That might make a pretty nice impact there.
Oh, the Blizzard Doomsayer combo gets picked up by Savitz. So if he ever does fall too far behind, I mean, that's always an option. I think we're likely going to see Savitz play a Berengeddon, I suppose. I mean, he couldn't hero power his own minion, although that doesn't leave him with too many options.
I feel like the Geddon is too vulnerable to the then 5-2 creature, and Death just takes care of Thaddeus a lot of the time. So I don't really like the Geddon too much, but I don't like the alternatives either, so I'm really not too sure here.
Yeah, I mean, as good as Savit's hand is and as far ahead as he's been, Frodan's hand is, or rather his board, is just inconvenient for Savit to deal with this turn.
What about just Blizzard and taking down Northshire?
That could be good. What would you do in this position, Hype?
I wouldn't mind if Blizzard Doomsayer tried to set up with a major domo with the duplicate.
Definitely.
Right now he's worried he's getting into the mind control territory though. So if he were to go that route, it would just Frodan could mind control, but then it's not really a good mind control target.
Oh, Frodan got his own stall log.
Oh, that's crazy. So this is really interesting. Frodan's actually in a position where he has a lot of initiative. If a big minion comes down, he has the mind control to just, you know, get rid of it, develop a second one on his own side of the board. And Zviz doesn't really have the kind of hand that can deal with that stuff.
All right, well, Berengeddon is pretty good here. It does take care of the 5-2 minion. It just doesn't quite kill Malygos, and that just looks scary. It's actually not scary at all, but it looks really scary.
It's true. I mean, I would like to see a Nefarian, I think, come down here for Savitz. Although Onyxia has its own merit, too. Just that Nefarian, if you steal something like a mind control, it's so game-changing.
Mm-hmm. Well, that is what he is thinking as well. Nefarian does come down. What is he going to get? Ooh. Not quite mind control. Looked like it, but not.
That is excellent for Frodan, not great for Savitz. That's not what he was looking for. That Confuse is a very thematic card, though, for the Thaddeus wing in the expansion. He's got that going for him.
Well, Frodan does have the way bigger minions here now with.
Yeah, and Nova's going to open up the Doomsayer line of play, and I think we're going to see Savitz go for it.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of initiate board control if you do that. I don't think players will actually be playing cards like Shadowward Pain, which would often be the priest counter to this. We've seen nobody play Silence. So,
you know,
I mean, what would Frodan actually do against this?
How about a Confuse? That would be pretty good.
Yeah.
I don't think he plays it, but...
No, I don't think anyone would willingly put that in any deck.
Is there something he could Thought Steal? Because we did see that card during the Mulligan stage of the game. So maybe get Thought Steal a Polymorph?
Yeah, I'd imagine for playing Mage, Polymorph does seem like a pretty good card to put on your deck. Looks like Frodan, if he's going to do nothing, he's going to at least cycle a Northshire as at this stage in the game with that hand. All right. I was going to end the turn with a Thaddeus, too.
I like it.
Is it time for Major Domo?
Oh, boy. If you play Major Domo, I guess you wouldn't die if you get Death, because I believe he has Ice Block up.
That's right. Ragnaros is an interesting line of play here. Is it... You really don't want to hit that minion. Maybe you do.
I don't know what you want right now.
I guess you want to... Okay, he's trying to set up for Berengeddon to deal with the Thaddeus, basically. Mm-hmm. He's a little too scared of playing the Major Domo right now, and rightfully so. It's a lot of power staring him down. But, yeah, you know, that's not
There's
the rag
death.
Hit that Savitz wanted. Frodan actually has initiative, a way to deal with Ragnaros. This looks really good for Frodan at this point.
The thing is, Death, it only costs 3 mana. It's one of the most efficient removals in the game, but it costs enough mana that you can't play another big minion this turn.
Yeah, and then it's 2 Ragnaroses going to Savitz. So if this game goes long, Savitz is definitely favored. Me? But he just doesn't have a way to deal with this Thaddeus. I mean, the minion is huge.
Well, he has the Confused Blizzard if he wants to clear the board and leave the Thaddeus on there, and then he can play Light of the Naru, I guess.
Wow.
Polymorph changes that up a little bit.
That is maybe one of the only cards Savitz could have drawn this turn to protect his Ice Block. I mean, at this point, Frodan still retains initiative, right? He gets to develop the first big minion. But
I don't believe Nefarian can have a 1-mana answer that pops Ice Block here. Oh, close, but not quite.
I think he'll be pretty happy to see the Fireball, though. Just more direct damage is what you want in this situation. And,
yeah, Frodan's just had initiative this whole game. He's had that one big minion up the entire game, and it's allowed him to have such control.
With both Doomsayers gone, is there any way Savitz can catch up on board?
Well, we've seen one Polymorph. There might just be another one. Really, Savitz's problem has not been, like, lacking removal. It's just lacking tempo.
Okay. Okay. Wow, he gets it.
That one out of three to survive.
And he should be good.
So, I wield the power. Brennan's going to be able to take out the ice block here. Could have Savitz at one less life, but not a huge deal in the grand scheme of things in this case. It might be, though.
Yeah, if he had one less life, he would have had lethal with double rag the face and ping. I don't think he can do anything here. Even if he heals himself, it doesn't really do the trick. Just nothing's gonna work here. That fireball's gonna seal the game for Froden, and Froden's gonna get game one with his pre-stack.
I mean, this really just shows how important tempo is, even when you're playing with slow, expensive cards. Froden was down so many cards all game. Savitz got three Ragnaroses. All this late game value, and just because Froden was the first person to
develop... the BMI slants.
Jeez. All right, well...
I mean, you're right about it.
But yeah, being the first person to develop, basically, mm-hmm. right? You just always stay ahead, because it doesn't matter how many big minions you have. As long as you never run out of them and you're always the first person doing stuff, you're going to win eventually.
Well, the limiting factor for both players, in fact, but Froden just had the initiative, you need to be able to play a removal card as well as a big minion the same turn. And it's hard to do that when it comes to like 8 and 9 drops. Now, I feel like each of these players only has maybe 4, 5, 8, or 9 drops in their deck. A lot of the legendary minions, a lot of the World of Warcraft raid bosses that they have to have 10 of in each deck are in that 5, 6 mana range. It's just, it didn't end up the case where they could play removal card alongside one of those. And Froden started to win at the start of the game, and he ended as the winner despite some interesting mind games results.
Mind games has been my favorite card of this challenge done so far.
And unfortunately, Froden won, so we won't be seeing it this run again. But if he does advance to the final, maybe we'll see 2 mind games priests against each other.
Mind games giveth and it taketh away. We've seen turn 4 Deathwing, turn 4 Doomsayer.
All right, well, that's just the first point. Froden is in the lead, but the lead didn't help Kibler. So we'll have to see. There's still a couple games that we'll have to play out here. Now, if you are in the losing position after that game, I mean, even going into that, I'm kind of surprised to see Savitz open with the Mage deck. And, he's continuing with the Mage deck. Is this confidence or maybe arrogance? What do you think?
No, his deck seems strong. What do you think, Hyped?
I'm not crazy about the Major Domo. He didn't even play the Major Domo, and he had the perfect setup with the Ice Block, the Ice Fairy, all that. And in the end, it only hurt him. If he had an Entity Effigy, for example, he would have probably been ahead on board.
That's true. Yeah, those tempo-based secrets are just so powerful against these expensive minions. But Savitz is playing the ones that encourage the Major Domo game plan, which are the ones that help you stay alive longer, the Ice Block, Ice Barrier, duplicate for more value. So, yeah, we'll see if that ends up hurting or helping in the long run. But from Froden, the only Shaman of the tournament, right?
Yeah, Shaman doesn't have too many strong cards in general, but it has one. You know, we talked about how important it is to remove something off the board and be able to play something else. Shaman is the best at that. Hex, silencing, and removing a big minion only for 3 mana allows you to have usually what is going to be a tempo option.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a very powerful card, but a lot of these raid bosses do cost 8 mana or 9 mana. So without the help of something like Emperor Thorsten, even Hex is a little too expensive to develop something in the same turn. This mid-range plan that the Shaman deck has going on, though, I like this a lot. Like, this could be very powerful. Oh!
Very powerful
indeed. I really like the Totemic and the Feral Spirits. When you have, like, a bunch of legendaries, you really don't want to be hitting totems, right? Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be super effective. We saw that neither of them had a Baron Geddon either. So a Baron Geddon would be insane against Froden's Shaman deck.
That's a good point. Ruby and Egg maybe to help hedge against that card a little bit.
Yeah, and Ruby is going to work against that and maybe some Doomsayer and some board clear plays. They're being very, very good choice, at least against this Mage deck.
Well, Froden has quite a few options here. Just going to decide which of his 3 mana cards to play. Does he want to coin out Totem Golem? Do you maybe just Totem Golem and Hero Power?
Or maybe you Totem Golem through the Tuskar Totemic once again. I mean, back-to-back, that's only 1 in 64. That happens all the time.
Froden is on the side of the board that I usually see that happening when I play Hearthstone, so wouldn't be surprised to see that come out.
All right. His legendary minions are so far away that I think he should just stick to the mid-game plan. He's probably just wondering what the secret options must be because he was confused last game with the 3 different secrets. And, I mean, if your opponent's playing 3 different secrets, it's not that unreasonable to assume there's a 4th option.
Yeah, so Frodan's going to go ahead and do the math on his overload for the next couple turns, deciding not to coin the Tuskar Totemic, because if he did, he'd be overloaded for three, wouldn't be able to do anything other than hero power. And yeah, just going to set up for a Tuskar Totemic next turn. Savitz is going to get some very efficient trades in with this Mad Scientist.
Is he going to trade here? He might want the duplicate. No, I guess he doesn't care.
He had the option to duplicate his Fiola before, and he just passed on it.
That's not a totem golem. That's just a regular totem.
Not quite as good.
Not quite. Fugin here, I feel this is one of those situations where it actually favors the Shaman, because the Shaman is running the better removal cards with the hexes and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but I mean, that's still such an important pickup for Savitz. If you look at his hand, if he didn't draw a playable large minion there, imagine he drew something like a Doomsayer or a 9-drop.
Actually, Doomsayer.
That would have been
fine.
A skip turn. Well, Doomsayer against Nerubian Egg, yeah, Doomsayer would have been fine. But either way, it would have just been a hero power turn, whereas here he actually got to develop the board. And, you know, we've talked about how important tempo seems to be in this format.
All right, well, Frodan almost went with the double sister play. Of course, in World of Warcraft, the sisters were part of the same encounter. They were the twin Valkyries of Trial of the Grand Crusader, I believe. That was an extremely fun encounter that we shared hyped a few times.
I do remember that encounter. I think I add TPSG every time, but that's just what I remember.
You might be right. I did have to do some of the raid mechanic positions for that encounter, from what I remember.
Okay, excuses.
Yes. Lined up. Welcome to World of Warcraft. All right, well, he is going to take some favorable trades here. I think Savitz really is just trying to control the game. He feels like with Major Domo and with just the bigger minions, he probably has the edge in the late game. I don't know if he actually does, but I mean, he seems to think so. That's the way he's playing.
That Rubian Egg is so strong right now. Berengeddon's a card that oftentimes will just devastate a Shaman board, but Rubian Egg is one of the strongest anti-AoE effects in the game, and that Mana Tide getting a second card is going to be so important. Most decks in this format, because of the nature of their curve, drawing cards is less valuable than it is in normal ranked mode, because you're drawing into expensive cards. You can only play one per turn anyway. Mm-hmm. But with a deck like Shaman, you can see Frodan has a lot more varied of a curve, a lot more cheaper cards. It's going to get him deeper into his deck for those hexes. And those are really the cards he's looking to pick up at this point.
Well, the highest tempo play would probably be the stall log and coining out the Fiola. But in doing that, you might delay your Nefarian or Deathwing one turn.
Yeah, I mean, that Doomhammer is a card that Frodan's also really, you know, looking to drop at some point, but a lot of options from his hand at this point for sure.
Right, I was going with Totem Golem, so he doesn't have to coin out anything. I like this line of play. I really do.
So Savitz is going to get two Fugins at this point. Two potential Thaddeus. Both of them have come down at this point. If that polymorph happens, though, that doesn't count as a Stalag having died, right?
Right. So I believe what Savitz is going to do is he's going to play out Fugin, and he's going to let Stalag trigger so that his Fugins trigger, and then he can polymorph Thaddeus.
Okay. Pretty aggressive tempo Nova here. Solid play. Frodan's just trying to survive to this Deathwing point, it feels like.
We talked about tempo. Frost Nova is one of those cards that actually, if you're marginally ahead or often even, you can just gradually push for just an obscene amount of face damage. It's basically as if we're playing Freeze Mage, but the fireballs are the creatures.
Yeah, it lets you dictate who has to trade. You know, if you get Frost Nova and you take a bunch of damage, all of a sudden, even if you were in an aggressive position, now you have to be the one trading into minions when you don't want to be. Well, Fire Elemental doesn't really take anything out at this stage of the game. I feel like all of Frodan's plays are a little bit clunky. Mm-hmm. He knows that if he saves this coin for one more turn without overloading himself, he has the option to Deathwing. But he also sees 13 points of damage staring him in the face. So really, no matter what he ends up doing here, it's a tough decision.
All right, well, that does not help in mitigating any of it. Frodan is just going to play out his hand. Oh, he plays a Totem Golem, which does actually stop the Deathwing from coming down to the coin next turn. And Savitz, while he doesn't have lethal, I think he has an extremely powerful play here by trading Fugin into Stalag, both players generating a Thaddeus, and him being able to drop the Blizzard to, again, freeze his opponent board while he is in a winning situation.
Absolutely. Ren Blackhand also picked up. Best card in Challenge Zone.
Yeah? Yeah.
This game does come down to a grindy point. If Deathwing does come out, Ren Blackhand is the answer.
I think Saviz is going to have Rend and Polymorph going into next turn. I feel like the trade Blizzard play is so strong. He saw a very similar play work last turn. There's no reason to doubt that it won't work again.
So Thaddeus is a legendary, right? He must be.
Yes.
Cool.
Well, it looks like Saviz is playing a little bit greedy here. It might seem like a trade play. Oh, no. More face.
Channeling his inner Rexxar, gets Dan all the way down to four.
Now you will pay.
Well, the Thaddeus is on the board, and he actually died at the end of last turn, so Thaddeus is able to attack.
Absolutely, but Savitz knows that he has access to things like Ice Block. If the game does come down to a racing situation where he has the minions, he's likely going to win just because it's very, very hard for Frodan to kill Savitz. It's going to take him a lot of time to get that done.
I believe the Hex and Fire Elemental play is going to put Frodan in a winning situation here on the board. Trade Thaddeus, coin Hex, yep. Frodan has stabilized, but how much can 4 HP buy you when your opponent is a mage with Ice Block at 29 with Ragnaros?
With Ragnaros off the top, maybe the best card Savitz could have drawn. At this point, even if it doesn't kill Dan this turn, that's just tough to come back from.
And there is no coming back as the Ragnaros will end the game on Saviz's turn, evening up the score. It is 1-1. We are again moving on to match point. But again, the players have 3 decks apiece, so they are not stuck with one deck, as often is the case in the Conquest format. There is a lot of flexibility, as is the case with Challenge Stone. And one thing we haven't seen yet is Frodan's Rogue. While I had some doubts on the maybe adventurous class picks of Frodan, even though he didn't win with a Shaman, I am more optimistic about the Shaman than I have been about Druids in this tournament on a personal level. So I'm digging the Rogue. I'd like to see what it can do.
Seems a little weak against Warrior, though, and not so great against Priest as it normally is. I think the Shaman would just be a stronger choice.
Yeah, I mean, the hero power is just so powerful. Like, the hero power of Shaman is so good in the Warrior matchup, so would not be surprised to see him go with that class. Hex is just such a powerful card, and Dan was a bit unlucky not to draw it early that game, which is one of the reasons that Baron Geddon kind of carried.
Yeah, it has been a battle of late game tempo. We've seen it won through better removals in the case of Priest. We've seen it won there with Saviz's Mage when it comes to just freezing the board and pushing for face damage constantly. But we haven't seen the third variation, which is Warrior. The strength of Warrior, we mentioned that they have Execute, they have Shield Slam, but you know, why are these important to have? It's because we have these 9 drops you can't play with any other removal in the game. You know, you can actually kill off something with Shield Slam and play Nefarian, whereas no other class can realistically do that.
Absolutely. It's really the only removal available that's cheap enough aside from Naturalize.
Well, it looks like we both won out on our bets. I want to see the Rogue play, you want to see the Warrior play. Not what Frodan wanted, but well, for entertainment value, this is the match to see.
I'm not convinced that this matchup is bad for Rogue. I can see this going either way. Rogue is a deck that can put a lot of pressure on a Warrior. It has things like Violet Teacher that, you know, if Saviz doesn't draw the clean answers for, it can be pretty frustrating to deal with. In this case, he does have the Deathbite, but...
Yeah, the Deathbite is the natural enemy of the Violet Teacher.
Frodan might wait to develop that too. Might lead on Gormok or something to...
Gormok has decent synergy with Violet Teacher if it does work out in the best case.
That's true. I wonder if Frodan is playing things like Preparation, more like tempo-based cards to help him gain control of the board in the late game.
It's difficult to play too many of those because you have to reserve such a large portion of your deck for the legendary minions that you must play in the Challenge Stone.
I did notice a copy of Sabotage, though, which will be pretty good in this matchup.
Definitely. So, hyped as a infamous Rogue player, one of the pioneers of Miracle Rogue, how do you think this matchup will play out, given that, you know, the Rogue is playing a much slower deck, much more late-game minions than the traditional list we see on Ladder?
Yeah, now that I actually look at the hands, the way you beat Warriors usually use a removal on your kind of like cheap cards, like Violet Teacher, they'll throw an Execute on that, your Azure Drake, they'll Shield Slam that, and then he'll just run out once he plays things like Fugin and Ragan, for example. Like, if I was trying to beat Warriors Rogue, I would just throw in, like, a few more big creatures, and they just run out of removal.
And that's absolutely true. But Sabiz has drawn double brawl in a row. It has to be too early. That hand can't really work out too well here.
That's, yeah, that hand looks a lot like my control warrior hands every time I try to ladder with the deck. I know that feeling. I empathize with Sabiz.
So you're familiar with the double brawl Rand Black hand tech?
Yeah. Well, no, not that part of the hand. Okay. The double brawl by turn five, absolutely.
Oh, I see.
This is where I squelch and start preparing excuses in my head for my stream.
But, well, the funny thing is, double brawl is often pretty good these days on turn five.
That's true. That's true. A lot of paladin muster for battle tokens, things like that. But yeah, Sweets is gonna prep that violet teacher for death to the death rattle of death's bite. Just use the word death a lot.
Well, Sabiz has a decision here between the Fugin and the Acolyte. The Fugin can't die straight up to the board, as Forerunner is only threatening 6 damage, 3 off the weapon, 3 off the Violet Teacher, but it seems like Rogue often has a way to deal 1 extra damage when it's holding 7 cards.
Yep, I am a fan of just playing the Fugin on curve. I mean, you really can't afford to be trying to hold on to your expensive cards. Is it Stalag?
Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing about this trade-off is that if both players get Thaddeuses again, sapping a Thaddeus is amazing because I believe Thaddeus is a 10-to-cast minion. It basically removes it. You'll never play that card in this format at 10 mana.
Yeah, it's a very good point. But it doesn't look like there's a way to deal with this this Fugin on board and develop a Stalag in the same turn. Mm. Not right now, at least. Dan's really looking for something like a preparation this game.
I am not sure if it's in the deck, but it looks like his favorable option, just by the way he's hovering over the card, seems to be a Fugin of his own.
Well, playing Stalag just into this board is definitely an option.
Sorry, with the Fugin for it. And,
all right. Kind of get a stalemate going. As long as mana is being used efficiently, I feel like both players are kind of happy.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think Savi's a little bit happier. He's going to end the turn with one more card. He's going to have board control.
Oh, that slam. Is that better than putting damage on your minion? I think so. Savi agrees.
Yeah, but now, even though Froden was the one who lost Fugin, it doesn't actually matter. Froden's Stalag is now activated, and he can either sap his opponent's Fugin or save sap from when Thaddeus comes out. I'm a bigger fan of just saving sap for when Thaddeus comes out.
Yeah, I mean, you still need to deal with this 4-6 minion on Savit's side of the board. That's not something that you can realistically ignore, so definitely needs to be dealt with at some point. And it's interesting to see Malagos again from Frodan, now in a deck that has a lot more use for it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Something like Fan of Knives or Blade Flurry along with Malagos is just absurd, and when so much of your late-game removal is based around cards like Ragnaros, it even dodges that. It's really only Ren Blackhand that can deal with Malagos.
So many options.
Well, it is the best card in Challenge Stone, so it can deal with anything. All right, well, Sabiz can actually initiate this by trading and then rending Frodan's Thaddeus. Frodan also has the answer with the sap, but Ren seems a little bit stronger.
That's an incredibly powerful play at this point. Savitz would pick up the Thaddeus as well, right? Because the death rattle happens after. So yeah, that's very strong.
Yeah, when Fugin runs into Stalag, magical things happen. And I think we're about to witness that, by the way.
Yeah, Savitz is considering it. He's leaning towards the Shield Maiden, it looks like. This might just be a bluff, though.
This is also something that's often very difficult to keep track of. I think if every game has Fugin and Stalag in it,
yeah,
you might forget if one is actually played and not the other.
Yeah, it definitely rewards a good memory.
I can take the hit. Looks like Sabine's just waiting. He wants to brawl first before he uses his Shield Slam and Ren, for example. Really actually get value out of the brawl and then force the cheap removal slash tempo play. So like Ren Blackhand is like a legendary with a free removal built into it basically. So he wants to save that for later.
Mm-hmm. All right, well this is a very, very good sap if Froden does choose to go with it. But he also has a few other options now with 7 mana crystals and the coin. He does sap, he actually doesn't end up playing too much else.
So many options.
Gormok the Impaler. Vile Teacher is off the table, so Gormok is most likely just going to be a 4-mana 4-4 this game. Wouldn't be too surprised to just see that come down.
Audius comes down, Gormok comes down, Sap comes down. Does the Deadly Poison kill the Acolyte? Doesn't seem much sense as it wasn't required last turn.
I think I would kill it. And the reason for this is that your Blade Flurry is most likely going to have value anyway, given that you have Malygos.
Mm-hmm. Same time though, when are you going to pay the 2 mana to put the daggers back on?
That's a good point.
All right, well, Savi's now saving the Rand. He has the Rand on the 11-11 Thaddeus plus the Shield Slam on the 4-4 if he does choose to go with a really high tempo play. But it seems like he might just want to use Shield Slam to get rid of the 11-11.
Yeah, so he's going to take up most of his turn here, deal with the 11-11, most likely develop a Fiery War Axe, and all of a sudden, Dan once again has that initiative we were talking about.
Does he? I feel the Fiery War Axe can take up the 4-4 with the Baron next turn, and if Baron plays too much, his Brawl comes down.
It can, but what if just Ragnaros comes down? Then that Baron Geddon play is not an option. Well, it is an option, but it's definitely a lot less appealing.
Mm-hmm. Ragnaros shaves off all the armor from Savi's. Still a very close game here. Oh, and Savi's gets another Stalag. Either Fugin or Stalag are both activators for Thaddeus at this point. I think you really have to consider that, because the Rogue can't actually seal out the game as the game currently stands right now. So those are going to make a big impact.
Yep. If possible, Dan is going to play around Brawl, most likely. Consider saving the coin for Malygos so that if he's on 10 mana, he can get immediate value out of it with an Eviscerate or a Blade Flurry. But yeah, Ragnaros is going to go down. Savit's still at a massive life total.
The draw here is really important, and it is a dud. Look at that. The second Blade Flurry is absolutely what you don't want.
Yeah, I wouldn't be too surprised to see a trade happen here. And yup, Fronaz just gonna hope Savitz does not have the execute, and he's going to be pretty disappointed here.
Yeah, it's a little bit too threatening to leave that minion up. And if he does, he might actually lose the game very quickly. So the execute does seem to be like the logical choice here. It's also probably a turn where one of the Fugin or Stalag bros seems slightly better than Sylvanas, which is so rarely ever going to be the case.
Absolutely. I mean, that's a 5-mana 7-4 Death Rattle summon and an 11-11. It's quite a minion.
Well, there's Sabotage a little bit too late, but he can deal with Thaddeus. The thing is, I believe Frodan sapped Fugin, so Savi's play of Stalag means that Frodan probably realized that he has to deal with potentially two Thaddeus this game.
Yeah.
What is the plural of Thaddeus? Thaddei?
Something like that.
Yeah. I'm sure we'll read about it on Reddit later. Well, you might as well play both of them. If sap is the only answer Frodan has to this, and he's played two saps.
Lothab pretty good against an all-spell hand, it turns out.
Yeah. Oh, the other sister comes out, but what good does that do? I guess you can eviscerate the Lothab and kill it with your dagger, which feels really bad.
I think it might be the play that has to be made at this point, though. It's interesting pointing out how low Dan is. You know, if he has to face tank that 5 damage, he's taking 7 from the Stalag, which...
He's at 4.
Yeah, I mean, that's dead to death bite.
But that's happening regardless. I guess he could trade if he doesn't want to take 5 damage. He can trade with his existing minion, the Fiola Lightbane. And the sisters are reunited, but not in a very favorable situation this time.
No, absolutely not. I mean, these are minions you really want to draw in your opening hand. You know, Dan's ideal curve would be take hero power on 2, develop one of the sisters on 3, and then just kind of play a tempo game from that point. But having to kind of skip turn 3 without a solid play definitely gives a warrior a really big edge in this matchup. Rogue is usually the aggressor in the Rogue on Warrior matchup, even in a format like this, with such a unique rule set.
Now, this is a point where Emperor Tharson seems to be really good, but I feel you really just want to threaten lethal.
Yep, it's a lot of ways to play it.
I guess you just go face and play the 2 guys.
Oh, I like
this. Did he just brawl?
I like this.
So even if you lose, you have 2 guys.
Okay.
Decent upgrade.
Yeah, strong.
That was a really good play, a really good brawl. Now, I don't know what Froden is expecting to get from Nefarian, but it... Well, I guess the sabotage may have worked if it landed on Claudius. That will not do it. And unfortunately, Froden will suffer the same fate as Kibler, winning the first game decisively, winning the trash talk battle, but in the end, losing the best of three.
It's that justice, man.
Yep.
Congratulations, Savitz. He's going to move on to the finals, play against Amaz. And yeah, I'm excited to see how that matchup goes.
Yeah, and of course, guys, that will be a little bit later tonight. It will be a best of five, so not only will two of their decks be tested, but all three will, which, well, I think might be a little bit more of a problem for Amaz. It seems like the Druid deck was struggling quite a bit, but anything's possible in Challenge Zone, so we'll have to see how that plays out then. But for now, once again, we have Rachel and Nimsh standing on stage with the winner for an interview.
Thank you so much, Krip. And what a match, you guys. Savitz, I have to ask you, we've been seeing you on the caster desk so much. What was it like to head back into the player booth for a while?
It was really fun, and I love the Challenge Zone formats. It's amazing to play on a big stage and play such a fun format against a good friend.
What do you think the biggest factor in your win was?
I don't know. I think that some of the decks were like, okay, I was a bit worried about the mage, but I still wanted to play it anyway. I never tested it. I didn't play it after building it. I was hoping that it would work out. And Major Domo didn't get played, but maybe in the finals.
Maybe.
Well, Savitz, I know you played some World of Warcraft, so was there any specific raid boss that you really wanted to play and showcase in this match?
Well, Thaddeus is pretty cool, and it came up quite often since then. Dan was also playing both Stalag and Fugan in all of his decks, I believe, so that was pretty fun.
Was that your main strategy coming into this this tournament as a whole, just bringing Thaddeus in all of your decks?
I don't really have any strategy. I just built the decks and tried to find some cool teams with all of them, and yeah, some good removal and no big Game Hunters, so I was kind of trying to pick the classes that have decent removal even without it.
Well played.
Well, Dan, despite your loss, there were still a couple shining moments, I think, in your play. What was your best?
There was one shining moment. It was during the mind games where I pulled a Doomsayer off his deck. I was not anticipating that at all. I really thought that this would be a very greedy meta, which is why I made all the choices that I did. And that was not something that I was expecting, so that was pretty funny. Well played.
Well, thank you guys so much. Congratulations once again to our winner, Savitz. We will see you in the Challenge Zone Finals at the end of the day. But first, we have our final two quarterfinal matches of the Hearthstone World Championship. First up is Daiming versus Kno, followed by Zoro versus Hotform. And for now, let's take a look at our match highlights brought to you by Windows 10 DVR Replay.
The 2015 World Championship Series Global